There will be no rebuttal by opposing candidates. This is not a debate, but rather a question and answer format. However, the questioner may ask for more time for a follow-up for a point of clarification, and the candidates will then have 30 seconds to respond to that. The questions will be asked on a rotating basis by the precinct reps, and the candidates will often be asked to respond to the same question and will answer on a rotating basis, but occasionally a question will be directed to a particular candidate. For the next hour, we'll be listening to the District 4 candidates for County Council, Michael Bernard, here on my left, Maddie Green, and Eileen O'Hara. We will begin with Mr. Bernard's introductory remarks. You have 2 minutes, sir.
Aloha. My name is Michael Bernard, and I am running for County Council to represent District 4. Puna continues to have unaddressed issues, many that affect our quality of life and our neighborhoods. At the forefront of these issues are health and safety. At the forefront, and these include added police protection for our neighborhoods and agreement on an exit plan during emergencies. In order to address any of our issues, transparency and accountability at the county level is needed. We must know where our tax dollars are being spent, and any issue at the district level requires resolve, hopefully compromise, and finally funding sources. With a broke budget approaching $500 million and over 2,700 employees, I understand the need to have a district council member who has experience in large budgets. As a businessman for over 25 years, helping to grow businesses into successful enterprises that employed thousands of people, I have the experience that is currently lacking. And as a volunteer for SCORE here on Hawaii Island, I also understand the importance of establishing and growing small businesses. The county is a business, surely a people business, and it must operate in an efficient and transparent manner. Anyone can come up with a wish list of pet projects, yet without budget efficiency and transparency, it will remain a wish list. As a parent, businessman, former special ed teacher, and substance abuse program manager, I understand the issues that face District 4. In my 40 years as a community volunteer, an advocate will add to that mix. I have not sought the endorsement from anyone outside of District 4. My campaign is self-funded, and I will represent the people of District 4 in a respectful and forceful manner. I do ask for your endorsement. I'm ready to get to work. Thank you.
And good mahalo, job. Mr. Bernard. Ms. Green, you're next.
Thank you. Aloha to all of you. Thank you for coming out and your interest in our community. My name is Maddie Green, candidate for Hawaii County Council, District 4. My family's tradition of public service runs deep, beginning with my great-grandfather, John Ke Po'okapu Kamoho Ali'i, who was the first sheriff of Puna in the 1800s. Over the past 20 years, I've worked to continue that tradition as a volunteer at the grassroots level. During that time, I've served as an officer and board member of Main Street Pahoa Association, on the Pahoa Regional Town Center Steering Committee, and the Puna Community Development Implementation Action Team, as a founding member of the Pahoa Schools Booster Club, as an officer of Nala Valley Community Association, officer and board member of the Pahoa Weed and Seed Program, and later as an officer and board member of Kokua Pahoa, board of Kanaka Puna, Drug Coalition, Puna Watch, and the Nala Valley Food Pantry for the Lower Puna subdivisions. I've been humbled and honored by recognition as an honorary kupuna of the Menapa'a in 2008 by State Attorney General for my work with Weed and Seed. In 2009, selected for the Hawaii County Council's Hall of Fame. That's not right. In 2010, recipient of a Hawaii County Achievement Award. I believe our island and Puna District hold the potential for a bright and prosperous future, but we face many ongoing challenges. Puna District now has a population larger than Hilo and is projected to continue growing faster than any other district on Hawaii Island. Thank you.
Mahalo, Ms. Green. Ms. O'Hara.
I'm just waiting while he gets that reset.
Oh, just okay. Go for it.
Okay. Aloha, everyone. I'm Eileen O'Hara, and I'd like to thank the Democratic Party, District 4, for hosting this forum. I've lived in Lower Puna for 35 years. After obtaining my doctorate in environmental economics from the University of Hawaii, I worked at HELCO for 5 years as a solar electric specialist, then 5 years at the county as a planner, and in 2003 as the county's first recycling coordinator, designing our recycling system and implementing the Hi-Fi program. I was a contract manager for the state hospital systems and business specialist for the $15 million Big Island biodiesel plant in Kau. I have been faculty at UH Hilo since 97, most recently teaching full-time at the Colleges of Business and Agriculture. My success as a grant writer has brought in millions to fund community-based projects. At the community level, I was appointed to the State Environmental Council for 4 years and to the 2010 County Cost of Government Commission. I was president of Hawaiian Shores Community Association for 5 years, leaving in April to run for county council. While I was president, we created a new ocean park, installed a solar-powered pumping system for our community-sized swimming pool, renovated our community center, and obtained a $2 million USDA grant loan combination to repair our aging public water system. My experience as president of my subdivision while recovering from Hurricane Isel in 2014 and preparing for potential lava inundation made me consider running for council. Lower Puna needs a council member who can lead and who already has political and agency contacts at the local, state, and federal level. The two issues in Puna that voters have identified to me as most important are the lack of alternative road access into Lower Puna when Highway 130 is closed, and the need for better police response. I've worked on these issues before and can successfully champion a solution at council. Mahalo.
Thank you, Ms. O'Hara. At this time, we'll begin with our question and answer session, and I would like to remind the precinct reps that you may ask a follow-up question if you believe it's necessary. There'll be 30 seconds. If they ask a follow-up, there'll be 30 seconds for the candidate to respond. So representing Precinct 1, Betsy Robertson, who will ask the first question.
Thank you. All right, this goes to each of you candidates, and you'll have 2.5 minutes to respond, just a reminder. Starting with Mr. Bernard, go down the row from there. And that will be the routine that we use throughout the forum. So Mr. Bernard, what is your understanding of the responsibilities of being a member of the legislative branch of Hawaii government, the Hawaii County government?
I'm sorry, I can't hear.
All right. What is your understanding of the responsibilities of being a member of the legislative branch of Hawaii County government?
As a county council member, I believe the council represents the people in their district, but they also need to be aware of their responsibilities and duties as a government employee and legislator. That's why I've stressed the need for transparency and accountability in my opening statement. I think those are key to get anything done. We can have a list a mile long of action items, but unless you have support and agreement, you're not going to get any of those done. And especially, you need funding for those. So I do believe that we are on the county council, representatives for the district and for the island of Hawaii, and we need to get along with all of the district representatives. You don't get anything accomplished unless you can get a majority vote. And that requires negotiation, mediation, and careful consideration of what you're proposing. Thank you.
Thank And Precinct 2 is represented by Tom Gagne, who has been...
Wait, I think...
Oh, I'm sorry. Never mind. My fault.
Well...
Would you like me to repeat the question? What is your understanding of the responsibilities of being a member of a legislative branch of Hawaii County government?
My responsibilities is really to my constituents. However, there are so many issues in our area that needs to be addressed. Homelessness, lack of multimodal means of transportation, but really the most important thing is that all council members work together as a team so that we can make our Hawaii Island a better island. And that includes working with our state representative, our state senator, that we can work as a team, because there are so much that we can do together and not alone. Thank you.
Told you.
Are we ready? Okay, I think I remember the question, okay. Betsy, thank you.
The responsibilities of being a member of the legislative branch of Hawaii County government.
To be on the council, it is our local legislative body, and in that manner, it collectively passes bills, which become part of our county code. These are ordinances and laws, as we often refer to them. So that is one of the primary responsibilities of the county council, is to pass new law and also resolutions. These do not have the same effect as law, but they are measures that tell the intent of the council and are sometimes referred to as feel-good measures, but they help to direct public policy. The council is the public policy setting body on the Big Island. And I really believe that the best way for us to function in our districts is to rely heavily on the planning process that involves the public. We've done a good job of this in the last decade of doing community-based planning, and I would like to see that continued, because we're just really getting the empowerment within the community to know how to do community-based planning and how to make it work. I would also like to say that working together with the rest of the council, there are nine council members, is important. As Maddie referenced, it's teamwork, and sometimes you have to make concessions in order to get things done in your district. But together, we have to set public policy for the entire island. We are also responsible for setting the budget for the Hawaii County. This is a big responsibility and one that I have experience in. So that, I believe, answers the question as best I can. Thank you so much.
My turn now. And I'd like to ask the audience if you would mind refraining from applause after each answer. We got a lot of questions going on. At the end, we'll give them one heck of a big applause to say mahalo for being here. So now, Precinct 2, represented by Tom Gagne. Tom's been the one that's been twirling the buttons on the PA system, but he's going to ask the second question.
Thank you all for coming. This is a little bit, you all touched on this with the previous question, so perhaps you can zero in a little more if you wish. But it's asked to please list the top three or four priorities for Puna specifically, and how you would plan to address each of these issues. Ms. O'Hara, if you could start, please.
I did reference it in my opening that two of the top issues that keep coming up from speaking to the voters in the district are road access. We have a combination of state and county roadways here on the Big Island, and the county roads that provide access in and out of Puna are virtually non-existent. We have Highway 130, it's a state highway. We need an alternative access into Lower Puna for the times when Highway 130 is closed, and that has happened a bit too frequently in recent history. So that is something that I intend to be working on. Another issue that's come to light is we have a lot of subdivisions in my district, large subdivisions that privately hold their roads. And having privately held roads that are open to the public, yet the responsibility to maintain those roads falls upon the shoulders of the homeowner associations is a problem that we need to address. And I have worked on this before, and I think I can bring some solutions to council on that particular issue. We also have a serious problem with homelessness, as Maddie mentioned, and that is going to take a public-private partnership approach in order to relieve the problems that we have here in Puna, and I look forward to working on that. We have a serious problem with drugs, and I know we're all aware of it. We don't like to talk about it, but we continue to have a meth crisis, and this is something that I feel very strongly about addressing if elected to county council. We have a serious issue that affects the whole island, and that is the closing, a pending closure of our landfill. It's not an issue that is only Puna's issue, but it's the whole island's issue. So those are some of the issues that I would like to tackle.
Thank you very much. Ms. Green? Yes, Ms. Green? Yes, please.
Okay. All right. Okay. Speaking with our people out there, employment seems to be one of the top issues for them, because without employment, they cannot feed their families, and that's where the food pantry comes in. But another one is medical facilities. We need a dialysis medical center here. We also need mental health services here. Excuse me. Because it's so, there are so many out there that I see every day, or I have seen every day, that need all of this medical attention. Because we have our kupunas that have to travel all the way to Hilo for dialysis treatment, and they're tired out and tuckered out by the time they get back home. So we need a medical facility out here with a dialysis and mental illness. And I think that Gilbert Aguinaldo at one time, a couple of years ago, was going to build a medical facility, a dialysis, but because we didn't have a wastewater treatment system, that got shut down. But he is still intending of building a medical system center here in his property, on his property. Thank you.
Mr. Bernard?
I mentioned this in my opening statement. I think that health and safety is one of the prime issues that I've been hearing from the residents of District 4. Those of us who participate in the HPP Neighborhood Watch and understand how to get things done, and I'm proud to be vice president of that program. With the help of our local police and a strong resident participation, we've been very successful in tackling crime and consistently seeing crime decrease and acts that affect our quality of life. But in conjunction with that, our police need additional support. They need support. It's a very large district, and it's covered by a very small percentage of police. We need additional police, and that's what I hear from the police department, to enforce our laws and keep us safe. This has already been mentioned, but I'd like to remind you that I ran a drug treatment program, and I have direct experience both with the people who are affected by drug abuse, but also the people in their families who are deeply affected by that. And I realize it's a very important issue here. And it's being addressed, but it needs more attention. And that would certainly be one of my priorities. And I have to agree that road access, emergency exits, is crucial. I went back down to 1998, studying the Puna Regional Circulation Plan, the Puna Community Development Plan in 2008, 2010. We have enough information to last us a lifetime. It's time to act on something. And you can't act on something unless you have you meet in the middle. The last 8 years at the state level and the federal level, people take one position and that they don't want to compromise. Being on the county council requires compromise to get anything done. Thank you.
Can you explain the background or history of the geothermal fund and how it has evolved? And how do you think the fund should be used? And would you propose any legislation to make that happen if you were elected to the council?
Geothermal, my favorite topic. Like everybody else's, you know. And geothermal, well, I guess it went back 25 years ago. I remember family relatives protesting the building of the geothermal. In fact, I think they're still protesting geothermal. I would like to see the funding used as something to take care of our communities. They're better. I know they're waiting on other, you know, homes that are being, they're selling homes, I mean, you know, paying people to relocate. They're using that as relocation. They're waiting on that. But maybe some of that money can be used for medical facilities out here that we need so much. Maybe our road access, evacuation road accesses. There's so many things that could be used, but how do we prioritize that right now? Because there are so many things. I wish geothermal will just let us have the money. Thank you.
Okay. And the other two of you, you're not off the hook yet. Mr. Bernard, what is your understanding of the purpose of the geothermal fund and how would you handle it?
Going back to 1993, and depending on which website you look at, Puna Geothermal was established, and in 2004, Ormat took over. And during that time, the county decided that they were going to listen to the people who were telling them that they were affected, either their health or mental health, and repurchase homes. And I certainly don't have a problem with that. I believe that the geothermal plant should never have been built there, but it's there and we need to address it. But I am not in support of reselling those homes that someone has told us make them sick. It's a sick house and you're reselling it. That is a class action suit waiting to happen. As far as the funding goes, the county received $1.7 million in funding on a yearly basis, and I'd like to see that kept for alternative energy, either solar or wind. If the state government can fund a green energy market securities to the tune of $150 million in a bond sale with the intention of lending money to households so they can establish solar, we should be able to get some of that money. Unfortunately, only 12 homes were lent money, and those 12 homes cost $21.1 million in that fund. The director makes $138,000 a year. Those 12 homes, that's 3 years. That's a total waste of money. We should be able to get some of those funds in addition to the funds that Puna Geothermal. We got plenty of sun. Let's use it. Thank you.
Okay, and Ms. O'Hara, your response to these questions.
Oh, thank you. I have been around since geothermal started. I remember the experimental plant, which ended up looking like it had been sent undersea and pulled back up because it was so corroded. We knew then that this is an industrial development, and we simply did not provide sufficient buffering zones in the original permitting process. As far as the relocation fund, these are mineral rights funds that are paid to the state. And it was allowed to build up for many years before any of it was spent. And it needs to be spent on relocation of people who feel they are being made ill by the geothermal development. And when those homes are purchased, I have to agree with Mr. Bernard, they should not be resold onto the market because the whole point was to create a buffer zone. And because we didn't have the foresight to do that initially. I would not advocate for the use of those funds to just any other use in Puna, although I do agree that using those funds to develop other alternative energies would be a reasonable consideration. But first, we have to look at the environmental health and the public health and use those funds as they were intended to alleviate illness in the area and also to ensure that we have adequate measurements off-site for the water that they're disposing when they re-inject and better air quality measurements. So I see use for that fund, and it is regenerated annually, but I don't want to just take money from that fund and spend it on any pet project in Puna. I don't think that would be appropriate. Thank you.
Not at this time. The questions are coming from the various precincts and given by the precinct representatives. So you're certain.
It's a public forum.
No, it's a Democratic Party sponsored event. Please sit down, or we may ask you to leave.
You can ask me to leave. If you want me to run away, and I can't ask any of these candidates questions,
yep. Can you sit down, please, sir? Thank you. And from Precinct 4, Roxanne Lawson, you have the next question.
Okay, now we're going to do something a little different. We'll ask individual candidates questions, and I'll be starting with Mr. Bernard. Mr. Bernard, what do you know about the Helion bus system and its shortcomings? What proposal would you make to help create a better bus system for Puna?
Sorry, sir, that wasn't about you.
Do you want me to repeat the question, or did you get
Please.
It?
Please.
Okay. What do you know about the Helion bus system and its shortcomings? What proposals would you make to help create a better butter bus system for Puna?
Better butter. Butter.
Ah.
That's a mouthful. Thank you for repeating. I'd like to thank the county council members who supported providing Helion. It's an important vehicle, literally, to get people out of Puna because we don't have very many jobs here. We don't have educational opportunities beyond. My students, when I was teaching at the community college, many of them used Helion. And coming to shortcomings, they told me that it was really difficult because they had other obligations, but it didn't go exactly to where they needed to go. And they would have liked to have seen it run a little more often. Mm-hmm. I think it's a great venue. I will definitely continue to support it, but I'd like to see it expanded. And expanded for the people, ask the people what they need. I know what my students needed, but I'd also like to hear what a kapuna needs. How are they using it to get to hospitals? How are they using it to get to dentists? Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Back to you, Betsy.
Mrs. Green, this is for you. As a longtime member of the Variations of the Main Street Pahoa organization, you must be aware of the sewage and wastewater problems affecting downtown Pahoa businesses as well as older residences near the ocean. Two questions. Can you tell us specifically what is needed to meet federal specifications to fix these problems? And what would be the county council's role in addressing this issue?
Good question. Well, first of all, The Pahoa Plan, the steering committee, we are already awaiting a wastewater feasibility study. We have the monies, the CIP monies, but we're waiting on the planning department because they're shorthanded, so they can't have anybody come out to do our study. The wastewater treatment system is badly needed here. So, and I would really push for the wastewater treatment. Well, I have been pushing for it for, I don't know, 4 or 5 years now to have that done.
Okay. And what would be the county council's role, or do you feel like?
My role as a county council member was to be sure that it is done. However, we have to listen to, you know, the planning department. We got to get that planning. If we only could work together, the planning department could just work with us, we'd have our wastewater treatment system.
Thank you.
Tom, next question, please.
We're on the topic of waste. We have Ms. O'Hara, that turning now to solid waste. Waste Management's wheel abrator technology is proposed to build an incinerator for $125 million before the county council killed the idea of an incinerator. Would you vote in favor of a Hawaii County building an incinerator if that is proposed again? Why or why not?
Good question, and I do have some background here as I worked in solid waste up until 2006. And we crunched a lot of numbers at the time, and the technology has not changed significantly. The size of the island's waste stream is such that it makes it not cost effective to even consider incineration, and the only way that you could possibly start to consider it is to consolidate all of the island's trash in one place. And if we're going to talk about trucking all of the island's waste to one place, then incineration becomes the least cost-effective method for dealing with the trash, because we can do resource recovery and divert about 40 to 50% of the island's waste from landfill almost immediately. We have room at Pu'uanahulu in West Hawaii, the West Hawaii Sanitary Landfill, that was prepped to do composting instead of just shredded green waste, which is contributing to spreading many noxious pests and diseases around the island. It needs to get composted. There's room there for doing the metal recycling, and that was all prepped and everything before I left the county. It still hasn't happened, and I'm not quite sure why, but we got to move on that. We did build a sort facility in Hilo. It was an expensive building, and the intention of the building was to bring in the solid waste from the 21 transfer stations over here on this side, only 11 or 13 transfer stations, gets dropped on the floor, separated, so all the recyclables are recycled, and the rest is pushed into trailers that could be trucked to West Hawaii. That is the most cost-effective approach at this point in time. So no, I would not vote for an incinerator unless technology changed radically.
Carrie, your turn now.
Okay, this would be for all of you. And there is two parts to the question.
Who starts?
We'll get to that. Okay. So I'm going to lay out a scenario here. Homelessness is a growing problem in Puna. There are a number of former county-owned transition cottages that have been stored behind Pahoa's Catholic Church for several years, not being used, apparently just sitting there and rotting. Would you, as our council representative, work with the community to find a way to use those cottages to help alleviate our local families' houseless problem? That's question one. Question two is there any other legislative solution beyond going after squatters that you would propose to help deal with the homeless issue? And Mr. Bernard, go ahead and start, please.
Thank you. I would be in favor of using those cottages. I've seen them. I was up there on Friday. But they're going to need a lot of work. And they're also going to need upgrading so that they are up to health standards, which will require money. But I know it's a major issue, especially in this concentrated area. So yes, I would be in favor of that, with the stipulations that they're brought up to standards. As far as the other legislature, you mentioned squatters, and as a member of the HPP Neighborhood Watch, and I happen to live in HPP and have had squatters in my neighborhood, two lots down from me for a year and a half, burning pieces of their house to cook, and they weren't cooking plate lunches. I think I would focus on that. I know that's not part of the question, but I think we need to do much, much more. I think Joy has introduced some legislation that will start to help the situation, but we need to do a lot more at the county level to convince the state. I also am in favor of the health department coming in and condemning houses. If you go down Cololi, at corner of Cololi and 25th, there are two houses there. One of them is partially burnt. Almost every night, this is not an exaggeration because I go there, there are squatters in there. The back of the house is burnt. It's not livable. Yet the police have to go over and over and over again. We finally need to address this issue. I don't know if you're aware of it, but there are some websites that tell people where to squat. Mm-hmm. They actually tell people where to go. Sorry, I get a little emotional because this has been directly affecting me. It directly affected my life and my family's life. Thank you.
Roxanne.
We're asking all the candidates.
Yeah. Now your turn. Me or Maddie?
Who? Yes, Mrs. Green.
Ms. Green.
You're next. Same question.
Okay. Do you want me to repeat the question, hon?
No. Thank you. We're talking about the homes in back of the Sacred Hearts Church. Right.
Yes. What?
I believe that Hope Services is working on those. Little by little, they're working on those homes. They even hired security because they've been broken into. And that, I think, belongs to Sacred Hearts. It's for senior housing. And I think it's for patrons of Sacred Hearts Church. That's the latest rumor I heard. Okay. I believe the prosecutor's office has now assigned a deputy prosecutor to the squatter situation. I think they are working on it. I've spoken to Mitch Roth on this, and at first we were giving him all the information. Now they're gonna be putting it up on a computer online so you can enter all your information in there. And I believe it's gonna be Rick Demerville that's taking over. That's gonna be assigned to the squatters.
I just asked for a clarification. You're in agreement that the squatter issue is a legal issue instead of a behavioral, a neighborhood of a mental health issue? You think that legal is going to?
To me, it's like a homeless issue, a houseless issue, and a squatter's issue all into one. That's why they squat in homes because they're houseless, and they travel. The only problem I have is those squatters that are dealing with drugs in those homes. Those are the ones that we really are going after. In Nana Valley, we try to do as much as we can to find all the drug houses and try to get all our squatters out of there. We started off with 36. We ended up with 18 by doing our homework.
And then addressing it as a legal issue.
It is a legal issue,
okay.
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
All right. Regarding the structures that are behind the Roman Catholic Church, that's property owned by the Roman Catholic Church and currently leased to Hope Services. Hope Services, we're waiting to see if they're actually going to get together to renovate and do the project they intended to do, which was Kupuna Housing. It may come to pass that they cannot get the funding for that, and if that happens, there's been talk at Pahoa Main Street and the Downtown Steering Committee about possibly entities, nonprofit entities, and or the county purchasing that acreage. I think it's 14 acres, is that right? Something like that. Because it has a lot of a road frontage with the bypass, and it has one of the four legal accesses onto the bypass. That property could be used not only for housing, but also for a hub for public transport and potentially parking and restrooms as well. So that is in discussion and is something I would support at council once we come up with the plan for that. As far as the squatter situation, that is a legal issue. I appreciate that our representative, Joyce Sambuena-Ventura, did pass legislation which makes it easier for homeowner associations to become the legal entity for homes that have basically been abandoned or lost in the reprocessing system of foreclosure. And that has been what has been difficult to affect as a homeowners association. As president of Hawaiian Shores, I dealt personally with 12 squatting situations, and of those, only one was a benign situation. 11 were drug houses. They burned one of the houses down, and they stole water from our public water system, robbing the neighbors of water. And constantly we were demanding services from the police, from the fire department, so these people were costing the community considerable dollars. And I think the definition of trespass is pretty clear. Now that we have Joy's bill on the books, it should be easier to move on this situation. And yes, there are people in the community that are acting as brokers for squatters. This is ridiculous. It's got to be cracked down on. Thank you.
Thank you to all three of you for enlightening all of us on the situation. Thank you.
Roxanne.
It is my delight that we have enough time to revisit the Helion bus system. Miss Green, what do you know about the Helion bus system and its shortcomings, and what proposals would you make to help create a better bus system for Puna?
Actually, I would propose that we have more buses more often, especially early morning for the school children in the Seaview, Black Sands area. The children have to hitchhike all the way to school. So we have an early bus. Maybe we should have a hub, which we're thinking about. If the county would buy property in back of Sacred Hearts Church, we'd like to do a bus hub there that we can send out the smaller buses into rural areas. And earlier times. I've seen children out on the streets waiting for the bus, and we need more bus stops, bus shelters, because now they're in the rain early in the morning. Sometimes I pick them up if I have time, but most time I don't. But and then I tell them, I direct them to go, you know, somewhere else to wait for the buses. So in Pahoa Town, at least we have shelter across of 7-Eleven for those students. But I really think of the ones like Hawaiian Acres, Fern Acres, and like I said, Kalapana, all those rural areas. We need more buses down in that area and more often.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And Ms. O'Hara?
Okay.
Same question.
Well, I do second most of what Maddie said. I think it's she's right on with the ideas. Some of the shortcomings of the bus system are that we depended on secondhand buses to start with, and so we now have a giant graveyard of half-dead buses that we're taking parts out of. It would be nice if we could get vehicles that were cost-efficient and be able to, once again, offer free service on the buses, which we did for a while, and the ridership was much higher when we did that. But we have to look at it long term in terms of the cost, and perhaps invest in perhaps hydrogen-fueled buses and that sort of thing. Smaller buses for the rural routes is really needed so that we can get down and into all of the subdivisions, because we have long, skinny subdivision roads, so that we can coordinate and create a bus hub here in Pahoa that has safe features such as restrooms and lighting. That would help a whole lot. But we need more buses, and we need them to run more often in Puna, definitely. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to segue into my question. Puna residents, this is to all of you, starting with Mr. Bernard. Puna residents, most of them whom live in neighborhoods with private, substandard roads established half a century ago, pay real property tax, sales tax, auto registration, gasoline tax, et cetera, but get absolutely no help from any level of government for upgrading our roads or connecting the subdivisions. Does this seem important to you? And if so, how would you address this issue?
It's extremely important. Again, it's a personal issue, but it's also an issue with everyone who lives in the subdivisions, that our roads are substandard. They are definitely substandard. And we need, I think comes down to a health issue, health and safety issue. But in order to change that, and you mentioned that these subdivisions were designed half a century ago with very narrow roads that don't conform to the standards of the county. Well, that doesn't mean that you say, okay, we can't do it. We can change the county laws to address at least the main roads in the subdivisions so that they can take care of at least that and our real estate taxes and our all of the other taxes that we pay, we can get additional benefits from. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Green? Would you like me to ask a question again, or you got it?
Okay.
We're on the roads, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. On the roads, well, I'm thinking of, you know, some divisions that have poor road quality, like Hawaiian Acres. I've been up to Hawaiian Acres, and they have holes as big as swimming ponds, mm-hmm, or... Mm-hmm. You know, I think they should be, but they don't have an association, I believe. Or if they do, it's not, they're not active enough to find somebody to really go ahead and try to improve their roads. In Nana Valley, there's some of our membership, they don't want their roads fixed. When we fill the potholes with gravel, they dig it out because they don't want these race drivers driving through. And anybody ever thought about it? One mentioned that they don't want any holes filled because then burglars and thieves can't have a fast getaway with all the potholes. I mean, true, that's what they said. So, you know, we did have the FTR, the fuel tax revenue that was supposed, you know, that we were trying to use for our roads, but I believe that was used for our disaster when the lava flow came.
So. Okay, can I ask for a point of clarification? Am I correct in understanding that you think the way things are now is the way it should continue? Or,
well, no, will you sit down? Sit down, Greg. Sit down. Sit. Thank you. It's my turn, not yours. No, I think that we could work with the county and try to see if we can't get work done there. I'm pretty sure, you know, I'm grateful teamwork. Work with the county to get the roads done.
Thank you. Okay. And
thanks, Roxanne.
Uh-huh. Miss O'Hara?
Regarding the road issue, which does go back 50 years to the creation of the substandard subdivisions, which in today's language would be called an environmental injustice, what we got handed in the way of substandard roads. But we have them, and we have to deal with them. As far as fuel tax revenue being directed at private roads, other counties are already doing this. This is a matter of legal opinion. Our corporation counsel opined that it was not legal under state law to use any portion of our fuel tax funds for private roads. And I worked with our senator in 2013 to try and change the state law, but because the other counties are already doing it, they felt they were being called out about doing something that might be considered illegal. And so the law did not go forward. It may just simply be a matter of obtaining a new legal opinion at the county level. At the end of the day, though, we cannot use our fuel tax monies to pave all of the roads in substandard subdivisions. This is not going to happen. We can empower our subdivision associations to get more capacity within the association such that they might be eligible for USDA loan funds. And this is a great attribute that is being overlooked here. We could get the lowest interest rates for the longest term through the USDA, but the community associations have to agree to pursue those funds. And as far as corridor roads in the subdivisions that lead through the subdivision to other places, in my subdivision, this is the case for a number of our roadways. The County Council passed a resolution in 2013 anticipating a change in state law and said that if that change in state law were to occur, that we would use some of our fuel tax funding for those main corridors. In other words, they identified the roads of highest priority for which those funds could be expended upon. And I think that was a wise move because we obviously cannot address every dead-end dirt road in our mammoth subdivisions in Puna. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We have time for just one more question. So, Betsy, you'll have the final question of this hour.
Okay. We're sticking with roads. And we are, in the interest of time, we're going to ask for yes or no answers.
Yay! Oh, nice.
Okay. Highway 130. Is one of the most dangerous highways in the state, and Puna faces constant threat from natural disasters. Do you support construction of a Puna-Mackay access road, whether with county, state, or federal jurisdiction, or all three? Do you support the construction of a Puna-Mackay access road, yes or no?
Where are we starting?
You go ahead and we'll go down.
Yes.
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 Okay, and the kicker, would you support the use of eminent domain to do so?
Yes, but it needs to have serious consideration first so that it doesn't end up in the courts of law for 10 years. Thank you.
I agree with Eileen.
I don't think there's any question that it would end up in the court. I disagree.
All right, thank you.
All right. Well, thank you, precinct representatives. We appreciate your time and your questions. We're going to now give each of the candidates 60 seconds to make their closing remarks.
60.
Mr. Bernard.
As a father, a former special ed teacher, and a substance abuse program manager, I understand the challenges facing parents today. As a businessman, I understand the need for transparency in county government, and as a small business counselor, I also understand the roadblocks to get up and running and become successful as a small business. And I also understand the challenges of those in my age group who spent their lives working so that they and their children can reap the rewards of that hard work. I will do everything I can to support District 4, and keeping in mind that I'm representing you on the County Council. I appreciate your time today. It's been very informative, and I continue to learn and grow with your input. Thank you.
Ms. Green.
First of all, I'd like to thank our moderator, our timekeeper, and our panel, and Frankie Stapleton and the Democratic Party for hosting this. I've often said I do not have a platform, but I have a diving board. If elected, I promise I will dive in and continue working very hard with and for you. Solving the many problems facing our community and taking advantage of the many opportunities available to us requires imagination and teamwork. I cannot stress teamwork enough. Over the past 20 years, I've shown that I can work well with others to get much done. I would very much appreciate the opportunity to use the information, good relationships, and teamwork skills I've gained from my experience as a business person and volunteer in our community as your representative on County Council. I humbly ask for your vote for Hawaii County Council person District 4. Mahalo, blessings, and hugs.
Ms. O'Hara, 1 minute.
All right. As a 35-year resident of Lower Puna, I would first like to thank the Democratic Party for hosting this wonderful forum. I can offer Puna an independent voice to represent your concerns and issues. People often ask what my agenda is, and I tell them my agenda is the constituents in my district. I'm not here to press forward a personal agenda. I'm here to represent you. I'm running a grassroots campaign with 90% of my contributions from local residents and small businesses. I've had the honor of receiving endorsements from the Sierra Club, from the Hawaii Government Employees Association, HGEA, as well as Puna Pono Alliance, which reflects my willingness to protect the health and safety of Puna's residents and the environment that we all cherish. If I had to describe myself in just a few words, it would be that I get things done. And with my background as an agricultural scientist and economist, I'm used to critical thinking. In closing, I understand the world of public policy, and I humbly ask for your support in the August 13th primary election. Mahalo.
Well, on behalf of District 4 of the Democratic Party of Hawaii Island, I want to thank you for being here, and I want to especially thank the three candidates for taking the time to share with us and answer the questions that were thrown at them. Let's all give them a really big hand. They appreciate it. In a few minutes, we'll take a 15-minute break. During that time, you may visit with the candidates outside in the lanai, and if you have further questions for them, that's a good time to do that. Those of you who will be wanting to be here for the mayoral candidate, that'll start at about 2:20. So if anybody's still outside in the lanai when that starts, please do us a favor and keep your voices down. And we appreciate that. So back in your seats at about 15 minutes from now.